I hereby announce the formation of the First National Bank of the Rachel Maddow Show. We are turning this television show into a bank, maybe a bank holding company. And you will be happy to hear that we are in really, really sorry shape as a bank. We are an awful bank. We are a terrible bank. We are totally on the verge of tanking as a bank. So, therefore, we will need to fill out an application for federal assistance for the First National Bank of the Rachel Maddow Show. Then, I think step two, probably we'll just go ahead with plans for the big holiday party. No need to delay, no need to hold back. See, the application for free money from the government, if you're a bank, is quite literally 2 pages long. I thought that was a joke until I went online and I downloaded it. If you Google TARP application, it just comes right up first thing, and here it is, all 2 pages. The first page consists entirely of lines where they ask you to fill in the name and address of the bank and a primary and secondary contact person. That's half the application done right there. The second half of the application, well, let's do it, right? Asks for the registration number for the company up there at the top. And then the next 3 lines are essentially questions about how much government money you want. This next line is essentially, how's your balance sheet? Then there's a yes or no question about whether you've gone online and read the small print at the Treasury Department's website. Yeah, right, like people read that stuff. It's like checking that little box when you download software. Yeah, sure, I read all those conditions. The next line is essentially, anything else we should know? And then down at the bottom, this is a really tough one. Down at the bottom, they say, state the type of company you are. Ooh. Probing. Then there's a line for the date. That's a hard one. And a line for the boss's signature. And actually, you don't even need to provide the boss's signature if you don't want to. It says boss's signature or the signature of a designee. You know, just for hoots, when we do the First National Bank of the Rachel Maddow Show application, I'm going to say that Bilbo Baggins was our CEO's designee and just sign that name just to see if they even notice. That's it, actually. That's the whole 2 pages. That is the full application process for a piece of the $700 billion worth of our money that the government is doling out. Have you ever applied for a loan for anything? House, car, small business, anything? Have you ever applied for public assistance, unemployment, food stamps, welfare? If you haven't, I can tell you this. The application asks for more of a commitment than name, address, how much do you want, anything else we should know, love Bilbo Baggins. For regular humans, that's not what getting a loan is like. It's certainly not what getting welfare is like, which is why I'm going to try to turn myself into a bank holding company. And maybe we all should. You know, since they didn't have to disclose much to get the money, the Associated Press followed up with some of the banks that received federal bailout money to ask them what they did with our money. They asked 4 pretty darn simple questions to 21 banks that received federal bailout money. Number 1, how much has been spent? Number 2, what was it spent on? Number 3, how much is being held in savings? And number 4, what's the plan for the rest? Seems like a reasonable list of questions, right? I mean, we gave them the money. Shouldn't we at least get to know how they're spending it? Not if you ask them. Some of the nation's largest banks told the Associated Press they haven't been tracking exactly how they're using the money, and some just flat out refused to discuss it at all. A spokesman for J.P. Morgan Chase, which received $25 billion in bailout cash, told the Associated Press, quote, "We have lent some of it. We've not lent some of it. We've not given any accounting of here's how we're doing it. We have not disclosed that to the public. We're declining to." Oh, you're declining to. Yeah, try that with your bank. The Associated Press says not one bank provided even the most basic accounting for the funds. Some were more evasive than others. On the one end of the spectrum, the most disclosive, maybe, was Wisconsin-based Marshall and Ilsley Corporation. They said, quote, the $1.75 billion in bailout money that they received allowed them to temporarily stop foreclosing on homes. Great. Tangible results. Thank you. I'd love some specifics, but hey, you're showing the right attitude. On the way, 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 way other end of the spectrum, we find the Bank of New York Mellon, which received about $3 billion bailout dollars. Their spokesman, Kevin Hein, said, quote, said he wouldn't share spending specifics and added, quote, I would just prefer if you wouldn't say that we're not going to discuss those details. we're not going to tell you anything, and we're telling you you're not allowed to report that we're not going to tell you anything. Now you can see why we should all become banks. Such a deal, right? It's certainly a better deal than being a car company. Chrysler and GM were just told, here, you can have $13 billion from your government, but you better deliver us a shiny new business plan, which we, the people, believe will revolutionize your industry within 3 months. Your executives better take pay cuts. You better get rid of those corporate jets. And failure on any of these counts will mean that you owe us the $13 billion back immediately. The banks, on the other hand? Ha! The insurance giant AIG, which so far has received about $150 billion of bailout money, your money, they're still the proud owner of 7 corporate jets. 7. J.P. Morgan, which we bailed out to the tune of $25 billion, 4 jets. Bank of America, $15 billion of our dollars, 9 corporate jets. The issue here is not just the double standard that exists between the banks and the auto companies. It's the jaw-dropping, knee-buckling lack of transparency that's being offered by the banks and that's being demanded, not by the government. Many Americans were scared into grudgingly accepting that we needed to do something, and maybe even something really expensive, to prevent the collapse of our financial sector and our economy. We hate the idea of having to do it, but many of us, and a majority of Congress, were scared into believing that it was necessary. And now, frankly, as things keep getting worse, it seems like the government may have to take a lot more expensive actions to try to stave off this economic collapse in coming days, weeks, months, and we hope not years. So there is a huge political peril here. The way this financial bailout is being handled maybe means the end of public tolerance for politically unpalatable but maybe necessary government economic intervention. They're blowing it politically. The inability of the Treasury to explain what it is they're doing with all this money. The plainly observable fact that the financial industry is spending a lot on things that have no relation to the health of the economy. Private jets. And the raw disdain with which both the Treasury and the banks are treating the true blue, totally understandable, fair and square American demand that if we're giving you the money, we get to know how it's being used, if it's being used, and that it's not just being funneled down some gold-plated corporate rat hole.
What the bailout does is help those who are concerned about the health care reform that is needed to help shore up our economy, it's got to be all about job creation, too, shoring up our economy and putting it back on the right track. So health care reform and reducing taxes and reining in spending has got to accompany tax reductions and tax relief for Americans. And trade, we've got to see trade as opportunity, not as a competitive, scary thing, but 1 in 5 jobs being created in the trade sector today. We've got to look at that as more opportunity. All those things under the umbrella of job creation, this bailout is a part of that.
Yeah.